Hey everyone, and welcome to She Plays the Podcast. I am joined today by CEO and co-founder of Athletes Unlimited, Jon Patricof. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Ashley. It's great to be here.
I just have loved hearing all the lead up to Athletes Unlimited. Absolutely love the softball season. I know we're soon into volleyball, but I would love to hear your evolution through the sports industry and how it led you to co-founding a brand new league.
Yeah, it's terrific. So thanks so much again for having me on. My career journey has really been, I guess, over the last 25 years, up through the media and entertainment industry, and started my career at Disney and spent some time in the investment world. And then in 2005, I joined the Tribeca Film Festival. Robert De Niro and Jane Rosenthal and Craig Hatkoff had co-founded the film festival after 9/11. And I ended up spending 11 years at the festival, kind of growing and expanding it into a whole host of new areas. It was a really exciting time for independent content and independent storytelling. And I worked to help build that and grow it. And then as I said, about 11 years in, I decided I was ready for my next move. And I got approached by the New York City Football Club, which is the MLS team in New York. And they recruited me to come be president of the team. And I told them I've never played soccer. I've never, been a soccer or even pro sports manager, but they'd seen what we'd done with Tribeca and the way we built the organization and the brand. And they really thought that it was a good fit. And I spent 3 years there. It was terrific. And at the end of that time, I really started to think a lot about pro women's sports and what I saw as maybe the next frontier and an opportunity in pro sports. I'd seen the growth of soccer and it really stood out to me. So that led me down a journey, which was really about 6 to 8 months of really pursuing a lot of different areas of pro women's sports. And through that process, connected with Jonathan Soros, who's now my fellow co-founder at Athletes Unlimited. And the two of us really worked together on putting Athletes Unlimited together and coming up with a concept and how we were going to execute it. And so that was a really long journey. But it started really with a belief that there was a commercial opportunity in women's sports, and that also pro sports was ready for, even more innovation than I think is happening today. And so that's how we started. And Athletes Unlimited is now a network of pro sports leagues, and softball was the first one this past August, but 2021 is a huge year for us. We have three leagues coming up, starting with volleyball next month.
Yeah, it's super exciting. And it is so unique. I mean, I think the model just around leagues themselves, that they're no set teams, you have captains and drafts. I'd love to hear about, just the brainstorming that went into, you said you saw you needed something different, or there was opportunity for something new. How did that come about?
Yeah, so I give a lot of credit to Jonathan. He really was somebody who, he was like a lapsed sports fan. He'd grown up a big sports fan, and then he'd kind of grown disaffected with kind of traditional team sports and a lot of like the intense rivalry that was existing and that it's all based around. It's so much of it. Again, like, yes, you're a passionate New York fan, but you're like, it's really based about like, you want to go kill the Red Sox or kill the Celtics or whatever it might be, and vice versa. And Jonathan had kind of started to think a lot about like, well, is there a different way we could really motivate and get teams aligned? And that led actually to us. And I was like, that's a pretty big, crazy idea. Like, it's interesting, but like, I don't really know even where to start with that. And then we started talking, and I said to him, well, I see some different opportunities for kind of innovation and how we might be able to change the structure of leagues. Like, I noticed in MLS, there was so much cost and logistics that were going into traveling the teams and putting teams in 20 markets. And I'd seen that through my time at NYCFC, renting facilities as a startup league. And it just seemed to me like there were a lot of ways to do things much more efficiently, especially given the role of media. But I would say that Jonathan's idea really got, like, we honed in on it because we connected with Angela Ruggiero and her partners at the Sports Innovation Lab, and they had done a lot of work, it hadn't really been published yet on what they called the fluid fan, and it started to like outline where they saw fandom going. And one of the big pieces of that was fans are following players more than they're following teams, and allegiances are changing more. And that really dovetailed really well with this whole idea that Jonathan had. And so our whole thought became, well, what if we really created a league where it wasn't about these fixed teams, but it was really about tracking a player's performance through the course of a season. And we let the fans connect with their favorite players. And so that was really the kind of connection idea. And we then came up with this very unique scoring system and the concept that players would change teams each week. And it worked really well. It worked really, really well. Better than we could have expected, honestly.
Yeah, it was so fun in the softball season to see the different captains each week and have a draft each week. I mean, that's a new event happening in the season. So it was awesome. And I love too the emphasis on athlete versus team, because I feel like a lot of athlete specific attention is missing in the women's side of sports. How have you seen, just in that this one season, how have you seen that really aid these athletes in their brand, their personal brand, and, you know, growing in their career?
Well, I'll say a couple things. I mean, if you step back and you think about what are some of the more successful leagues today in the world, I certainly think we spend a lot of time talking about and thinking about the NBA. And I think they've probably been the most successful in really building the individual personalities of players. And I think that it's been a really a big recipe for success. And I think that in some other leagues, which I love, and I love baseball, I love hockey, but like, I think you can certainly point to MLB and NHL struggling a little bit because they haven't been able to build the personality. So I think this is not something that is like a new concept. I think it's been used elsewhere. But for us, it's really the case that, like, if you're going to start a new sports league and a new sports property, you know, that's really hard to do. And so the concept that you want to start the 12th or 13th pro team in the New York market or the Chicago market and try to all of a sudden like capture, you know, regional loyalty or city-based loyalty, like there's just no way to get around it. And I saw that with Major League Soccer. Like you come in as the 9th or 10th team in the market and it's just, you're clawing for attention and everything else. And so it just doesn't seem like a very smart market. And when you look at women's pro sports, these women have been incredibly successful at the college level, even at the youth level. They've been building followings. They carried those followings with them, you know, from maybe their youth level, but certainly through their college level. And that's really the basis for their support. So we really wanted to lean into that and leverage that, as opposed to leveraging, you know, quite frankly, a made up name of a team that will have no history in a given city. So that was really the idea. Let's take the strength that we have, which is these individual players, followings and personas.
When it was, I don't know if it was just fortuitous or not, but you know, the model of bringing everyone together. And like you said, the one place, which I hadn't even thought about, yeah, that would save so much for renting facilities. That's like genius. But that really lended itself well in the crazy year that 2020 was. I mean, being able to have a bubble. I just love to hear your thoughts on the inaugural softball season.
Yeah, it was crazy. I mean, just remember, we announced Athletes Unlimited on March 3rd of 2020. Mm. So it was literally, you know, a week or so before COVID kind of hit and then the sports world got turned upside down. We'd been working on that business plan for 9 months. So unlike every other league out there that was scrambling and thinking about, okay, what are we going to do and where are we going to create our bubble? I mean, that had been our plan all along. We knew we were going to go to Rosemont and we had a 6-week season and we were going to be there, and none of that changed. I mean, obviously the big thing that changed was we didn't have fans in the stands, but that really wasn't a huge deal for us from a business model standpoint. So I mean, it was surreal. Like we didn't have to spend any time really reorienting ourselves around that. The softball season went incredibly, incredibly well. We had 30 games. The first week was a preseason. So I say 6 weeks, it's really a week of preseason and then 5 weeks of a competitive season. And we had 56 athletes there, amazing athletes, over 20 Olympians from foreign national teams. It was awesome. 30 games games were on ESPN and CBS. We had a great group of partners from Nike to Geico to a whole host of others. And we really got to work with the players. I mean, I think the best part about this and probably the most unique element of Athletes Unlimited is this is a player driven league. We have what we call a player executive committee in each sport. I actually just got off a call with our softball player executive committee, which we have now biweekly, but they're usually weekly. And we have a volleyball player executive committee and a lacrosse player executive committee. And that's where all the decision-making happens. So today we're on that call with the player executive committee and we're talking about player recruitment and we're talking about partnerships and we're talking about announcement deadlines and we're talking about policies and everything. So that's where the decision happens. And the best part of what made Athletes Unlimited work was it was awesome competition on the field, but the athletes really stepped up and really created something special off the field as well. So great community of one another supporting each other and creating something really special. And I think that came through. We talked to a lot of fans and it's you know, great to hear that you followed it. But one of the things that really stood out, I think, for fans is they saw that the players were totally into it and totally enjoying it.
And that,
I think, is very different than a lot of pro sports leagues.
Well, and too, that unique environment of competition where, yeah, we might be on opposite teams to like this week, but next week we might be on the same team. So, you know, I think it is a unique space. And we had Sam Fisher on the podcast and she just raved about the first season. And it was just so cool to hear her perspective and how they really felt valued as athletes in ways that they had not felt before. So kudos to your team on really stepping up and doing that. I think it's only going to get better from here. And so volleyball, yeah, starts end of February in Dallas, Texas is the plan. What are you excited about there?
Oh, wow. Well, with volleyball, it's so fascinating because that sport is such a huge sport globally in terms of 900 million people playing the sport around the world. It's different than softball, right? I mean, softball has such deep roots and kind of a history as it's tied to baseball, but also on its own at the college level here and everything. I mean, it's really succeeded on television and it's got more of a history. In the U.S., you know, there's no pro indoor league for men or women in the United States right now. There hasn't been for a long time. So the concept that we're coming in and we're really creating like the first league in a long time, and we've got great players from the United States and all around the world, it really feels like a very, very special moment. So I think with that one, I'm super excited for that, not just to get off the ground and be impactful in the United States, but really like, you know, the fact that we'll have the world watching in a big way. And I think that's a really cool moment for us.
Yeah. I mean, I think in just some chatter that I've seen and been a part of on Twitter, the fact that it is something that, you know, so many girls go through high school playing volleyball and maybe they make it to college, but then it's like, and then I only get to watch it at the Olympics or something. I wish I could see it every day. I think it's going to be huge. And you do already have also, I think CBS Sports and Fox Sports are going to broadcast the games. I would love to hear, I think that is one of the key pieces missing in women's sports is the broadcast opportunities. So, you know, you were able to do that in softball, now in volleyball. What kind of is the, you know, have you seen it make an impact through softball, and what's that opportunity like for your league?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I tell everyone, it wasn't easy to get the first deals together for softball at all. Like, I mean, it was a challenge. I mean, I think it would have been a lot easier if we'd said, hey, we're a traditional league format and we're a pro softball league format like you know before. But we were coming with a very, very new idea. And even the broadcasters, I mean, listen, they have a lot of viewers, their time's valuable. And they were saying, well, listen, is this going to work? Like, are fans going to understand this? And so the good news is sitting here today, a few months after the conclusion of the season, our broadcast partners were really, really happy and gave us incredible feedback. I mean, obviously not just fans, but they saw it and they know what makes good product and what works on television, and they were really happy about it. So it's worked incredibly well. As we said, we're heading into volleyball now. It's a 30-game season. It's actually a little bit different than the sense that we'll have 7 games on CBS, we'll have 15 across Fox Sports, and then we're actually going to have 8 that are going to be available digitally on Facebook and a handful of other platforms. And that, I think, will be an interesting, you know, evolution too for fans, because you'll be able to see them, with an internet connection anywhere in the world. And that's right. Going to be, I think, an awesome way for people to get broad access. But I think there is no doubt, and we've heard this from advertisers and we've heard this from fans, we've heard this from players, TV and TV association and TV coverage still is the gold standard in sports, and it's still what matters and still really, really important. And so we're very fortunate that CBS and Fox are on board, and ESPN and CBS are such good partners around softball.
Awesome. I love it. It's just, and it is that validation that yes, like put it on, people will watch. I think you guys are leading the way in a lot of that, of proving that to be true. So again, kudos to your team. You have an amazing team that you guys have assembled to lead this league. What are your, you know, big hopes for 2021 and beyond for Athletes Unlimited?
Yeah, I mean, so as you said, the kind of, we head into 2021, the volleyball season launches February 27th in Dallas. And then our second league will be lacrosse. So pro women's lacrosse will take place in July through early August. And then we'll have softball mid-August through September. So if I had to say kind of what our hopes and aspirations are, I would say, I mean, obviously we want the first and foremost is always like, are the athletes coming and having great experiences? They clearly had a great experience with softball. I want to see a lot of those players return for year two. And you know, that'll be a great testament that they had a great experience and want to come back. And I think we're already seeing that in the volleyball and in the softball community with players reaching out to us who didn't even play year one and are like, hey, listen, I really am now thinking I want to come play here. With lacrosse and volleyball, obviously we have to get off to a good start. The players have to have amazing experiences. But what I'd really love to start seeing, and I think this will be a really an interesting test for Athletes Unlimited, is we do have this concept that we're a network of leagues, right? And that's never really been done across sport. I mean, the NFL is a football league and the NBA is a basketball league and the NWSL is a soccer league. I mean, and they may do different things in their sport, but they don't typically cut across sport. And so for us, one of our ideas is that there is this fan that will go from sport to sport with us. Some people won't. Some people just love softball or just love volleyball. But we are hopeful that we can identify a group of fans and we'll be able to prove out that softball fans watched, they loved it. And then they were like, hey, listen, this is so cool. I want to watch volleyball. And they'll have a good time and we'll do a good job keeping them engaged and then do the same into lacrosse and et cetera, et cetera. I think if we can prove that out, that's going to be so exciting. And I think we'll really, really turn kind of the concept of pro sports leagues on their head.
Absolutely. I agree. Yeah. So that'll be fun to see. And I wish you guys all the best of luck. Like I said, I'm a fan myself, but we're at She Plays big fans of you guys, and we'll continue to promote. I would love if you wouldn't mind sharing where people can find you and the league and all the links that they can, we'll put in the show notes.
No, thank you. And thank you guys for all the support and having a great platform. And I think that, listen, I think we've talked a lot about this, but I think we all know that, and I will say, like, being on Fox and CBS or ESPN is great, but what really is going to make the difference, I believe, in women's sports is this ecosystem of promotion and marketing and editorial coverage. And let's not kid ourselves that, like, just being on TV is not enough. It's going to require, and it requires, you know, things like what you're doing, Ashley, and others. Like, it's this kind of snowball effect of, like, they're just being more chatter and it being more and more visible and everywhere, not just during the games, but as we know, fans increasingly, you know, you can be a huge fan of a sports league and not necessarily even watch the games. You can just want to engage in it on social and engage it in different places on podcasts and elsewhere. So huge thanks to you. So for me, first of all, I'm at Jay Patricof on all the social handles. If anybody wants to find me on Twitter or JC Patricof on Instagram, but then Athletes Unlimited, we're at all AU Pro Sports. So AU Pro Sports on Twitter and on Instagram, on TikTok as well, which is an awesome platform for us. If you want to check us out, if people are interested in job postings, you can see us on LinkedIn, of course. And then really just check out our website, auprosports.com. That's where everything is. You'll be able to see the schedules as we you know, come up with them, and we'll release the actual game schedule for volleyball, you know, soon, sometime in the next 2 weeks. So keep an eye out there. We have an amazing content and social team. I know you know a number of them, but a team led by Anya Alvarez, and we have an amazing group. Quite frankly, almost all women. There are a couple guys on that team, but it's a very female led team that is doing some amazing long form storytelling, as well as, I think, giving, you know, fans a great way to engage kind of in you know, short, you know, social ways as well. So it's fun.
Yeah, I personally do have to say real quick, I love the bullpen, like, phone calls and, like, check-ins and the, like, some of that stuff that was available for, like, premium subscribers too. Genius, like, really, just, again, well done by your whole team. And we're so excited. Like I said, all those links will be in the show notes. Be sure to tune in end of February, February 27th, I believe, volleyball will kick off. And yeah, just thanks again for coming on the pod.
Thanks, Ashley. Great to see you.